Hello, everyone. My name is David Pettyjohn. I am the director of the Idaho Humanities Council, and I want to thank you for joining us for today's connected conversation discussing the life of John Denver. And before I introduce, you know, our very special guest today, I want to remind you that this is one of the many programs that we offer here at IHC. And if you would like to learn more, you can visit our website at www.idahohumanities.org. Also want to let you know that if you have any questions for Bob, you can use the Q&A feature located at the bottom of your Zoom screen, or you could type it into the chat feature that will go to the panelists. So joining us today is a very special friend of the Idaho Humanities Council, Bob Santelli. He is the director of the Grammy Museum. He and I were just visiting about all of his travels across the country. And he has also been a part of our annual Summer Teachers Institute. He is an absolutely delightful person and a wonderful presenter. And it is my honor to turn it over to you, Bob. Thank you so much for joining us today.
David, thank you for having me. I'm happy to be here. As always, as you mentioned, I have a long and I hope mutually beneficial and rewarding relationship with Idaho. I'm currently coming from you from Oregon today, down in Corvallis, Oregon, but my home is just outside of Seattle. So it's an easy jump for me to get over to Idaho, and I try and get there whenever I can. It's one of my favorite states, as you know. It's wonderful to talk about John Denver for a number of reasons, which I'll get to in a second. But let me just tell everyone the way this is going to work. So I'll go for about 35 or 40 minutes or 45 minutes, whatever it takes. We're going to play some music, but mostly I'm going to give you information. And the whole goal of this is not just to explore the life and legacy of John Denver, particularly the music, because after all, that's my area of expertise. It's about the music as much as anything. But also, I'm going to leave time for you to so we can have a discussion on this. I'll try and answer any questions that I can. I can't say I can answer them all. Certainly will do my best. But I'd love to hear from you too. So this is John Denver is an American icon, and he is someone who often inspires a lot of great conversation, as you will see. So feel free to put some questions down in the chat, and then I will get to them after the presentation is over. All right, so let me get started then, and say, you know, it's when David, when you asked me to do this, It was really apropos because for those of you who don't know, as David said, I am the founding executive director of the Grammy Museum. And a few years ago, we did an exhibit on John Denver. Okay. And basically, I'm trying to remember exactly what year it was, but essentially it was called Rhymes and Reasons, the music of John Denver. As a matter of fact, if you go to the John Denver website, I'm pretty sure you will be able to get a link to a virtual tour of that exhibit. Here's the thing about John Denver. So when we are in our curatorial discussions and with the way we select exhibits to create and then to present to our audiences, we get together with a whole bunch of people, marketing people, curatorial people, education people, hardcore music historians. We all sit around a table essentially, and we try and figure out what is a good exhibit to present. Now, understand, I work for the Grammys. If you know anything about the Grammys, you should know that it's about all kinds of music. So previously, I used to work with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. That was kind of easy because the music was just about rock and roll. When you talk about the Grammys, you're talking jazz, opera, folk, hip hop, blues, you name it. And all of it kind of falls under the Grammy umbrella. So we're talking about, okay, what should we do next? And someone, I can't remember who, says, why don't we do something on John Denver? And I remember distinctly a number of people around the table kind of frowning and smirking, saying, John Denver, Really? You want to do John Denver? And a discussion ensued there. And part of the reason why there were those frowns and like, I don't think so, is because, and we're going to get into this in a little bit, is because John Denver's relationship with music historians and critics, quite honestly, is not very high. They often look upon him as kind of a folk pop rock lightweight, which isn't true, as we'll see in a second. But that has been one of the things that the John Denver family and fans have really striven to overcome. And so it was very prevalent in our curatorial table. Nonetheless, we decided to go and create an exhibit on John Denver. Now, I'm telling you this because when we opened it, and during the life of the exhibit, which was, I don't know, 4 months, 5 months, whatever, it became one of the most popular exhibits we had ever done in our 12 plus years of being in existence. Shocked us all. It shocked especially the skeptics, the John Denver skeptics. Those who advocated for John Denver said, "See, I told you so." Apparently, and you may be, we have a number of people here, I'm sure, are hardcore John Denver fans. Those people are loyal and they turned out for this exhibit and then passed the word. We were overwhelmed with kudos for actually doing this exhibit and saying, see, the Grammys ought to recognize John Denver, because as you'll see later on, when John Denver was alive, he only won one Grammy Award, despite the fact of, I don't know, he did something like 30 albums and only one. And it was his children's album, his last album, actually, that won a Grammy Award. He also hosted the Grammy Awards a number of times, actually, late 70s into the early 80s. And so we should have realized that there is and was a very strong connection to not just John Denver's music, but what his life stood for as well. So I'm proud to say that exhibit killed it for us. We were overwhelmed with John Denver fans, and they were very happy for it. I would suggest that you go to the John Denver website, and you'll be able to cue it and get some photographs at least of what it looked like. We got 110% support from the family, and you'll see a lot of very personal objects that we had on display that people literally came from all over, John Denver fans from all over to see this exhibit. So that's the good news. Let's go back to what I just said about his reputation. So John Denver, when you talk to a music critic or you talk to a music journalist, especially older ones, now full disclosure here, for many years, for 18 years, actually, I was a music critic, a music journalist, but particularly a music critic. And I wrote for Rolling Stone and many other publications, New York Times, Guitar Player. And I'm from New Jersey. You could probably hear that in my accent. So I live back east, where John Denver's music about the Rockies in Colorado did not necessarily connect in that urban setting so much. And that's where most of the rock critics and music critics lived. And so John Denver never had, I don't think, a decent shot at convincing the hardcore New York-based urban music critics of the validity of his music. And so he had routinely had to fight negative reviews or people just saying, oh man, lightweight. And it's only been recently, and I like to think that this exhibit at the Grammy Museum, that this has begun to change. And it often changes because many of the original music critics that I'm talking about, myself being included, being a baby boomer, are retiring and have basically left music journalism. And there's a new generation of younger music critics and journalists who now basically sit in the same seats that we once did at magazines like Rolling Stone, et cetera. And they have a different view. And so we're starting to see a bit of a revisionist point of view when it comes to John Denver and his music. And I think part of the reason is because, as you guys probably well know, he was a really hardcore environmentalist. and we'll talk about that in a second. But John Denver's environmentalism is starting to ring loud and clear with young people today who are very interested in climate change and very interested in seeing what's happening with animals and plants and things that are basically becoming extinct. And so John Denver now, as a person, as well as an artist, a recording and performing artist, is starting to ring more true and have more validity than he did, say, a generation ago, which is kind of interesting. And I think really a good thing for his legacy. And I think as time moves on, you're going to see that legacy grow even more and more. Okay, so with that said, let's just talk about his music, what he stood for, where he came from, what are his roots. So we do know, obviously, that his music is, it's not that easy to categorize because some people see him in country music, okay? Some of the songs, of course, just with their titles, which we're going to hear in just a second, certainly allow Denver to easily fall into the quote country category. Some people see him in the pop world, okay, where, because his music was certainly popular. And when you're in the world of pop, you draw from all different kinds of musical influences. And so it's a great catch-all category to put people who aren't specifically in one or the other. And there are others who see him in the folk category. All right. And why? Because as we'll see in just a minute or so, he really comes up as a folk singer during a whole folk revival of the early and mid 1960s. And therefore, it's an easy place to put him. The fact is, at least as far as I'm concerned, is do these categories really matter? No, they don't. Of course they don't. No artist likes to be categorized at all. As a matter of fact, they detest it. A blues artist hates to be called just a blues guy, especially if he plays rock or soul or gospel as well. It's really difficult. But in the world of music, when you talk about the music industry and consumers, this categorization happens simply because it's easier to sell stuff. When someone says, well, what kind of music does he play? And you can say, oh yeah, you know, the Rolling Stones, they played blues-based rock and roll. Okay, let's put them in rock and roll. So it's easy to do and it's easy to connect. That's why it happens. But I am here to tell you, and I know this for a fact, musicians hate it. And I'm sure John Denver did too, because even though he did draw from country, particularly his influences, and even though there were folk roots in his music as well, and even though he was a pop singer as well, he was all of this. He was all of this, and maybe even a little bit more, as we'll see. So with that said, the idea of John Denver as an emerging artist, he is someone, first of all, he's born in New Mexico, and he really doesn't get going until the early 1960s. He comes from a Air Force family, which means he moves around quite a bit. He probably does not have a great relationship with his father. And, you know, thinking about John Denver, I often think about Jim Morrison from The Doors, who also came from a completely different kind of music for sure and life. But he also came from a family that was hardcore into the military. In his case, his father was an admiral and rejected, and they had that whole rebellious thing going on. And I kind of understand all of that, because growing up being a musician in the late 1960s and early 1970s myself, my father was a New Jersey state trooper, and the last thing he wanted to see is his son holding a guitar. He and I did not see eye to eye, and I don't think Morrison, and maybe John Denver had a little bit better relationship, but probably not that much. It simply was the times mostly. And of course, he does go to college for a little bit. He goes to Texas Tech and studies architecture, but clearly he's interested in being a musician. So basically, this is the early 1960s, all right, 1963, 64, 65. And if you know anything about that time, first of all, let me put it into a timeline for you. In 1964, the Beatles come to America for the very first time. So 1964 is all about Beatlemania. But just before that, We meet Bob Dylan for the first time in 1962 and 1963. And what is happening, not just on the East Coast in places like Greenwich Village and up in Boston, but also on many, many college campuses, there is a folk revival going on. So young kids who basically were introduced to rock and roll through Elvis Presley and Chuck Berry in the 1950s, the mid late 1950s, now have moved on to college. They're looking for music that has a little bit more sophistication rather than lyrics like 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock rock, right? This Rock Around the Clock, of course, by Bill Haley. And a lot of kids start to move toward folk music. There's meaning in folk music. And John Denver is one of them, okay? So John Denver basically grows up in this folk world, in this folk world. And in addition to having this solo artist, such as Joan Baez, Judy Collins, Bob Dylan, of course, there are also groups. There are singing groups, all right? And these singing groups are really, really popular in the early 19 and mid 1960s. The most important one, which we'll hear about in just a second, the most important one is Peter, Paul, and Mary. Another one that's really, really important is a group called the Chad Mitchell Trio. And even though John Denver is not an original member of the Chad Mitchell Trio, he does join the Chad Mitchell Trio. And basically up until about 1969 or so, when he decides to go solo and have a solo career, basically he is embedded into that folk revival slash folk rock scene that has traditionally been put forward by Bob Dylan and groups like the Byrds, but also more traditional folk singing groups like Peter, Paul, and Mary, Four Freshmen, the Chad Mitchell Trio, etc. Okay. Interestingly enough, it's Peter, Paul, and Mary that will really put John Denver on the map, on the pop map, because he writes a song that's on his first record, which gets little or no attention, called Leaving on a Jet Plane. Peter, Paul, and Mary get a hold of it, and they record that song, and it goes to number one on the pop charts. It's there basically what Peter, Paul, and Mary would do is Peter, Paul, and Mary would look for other songs and then reinterpret them. They did that with Bob Dylan's Blowing in the Wind. That wasn't a big hit for Bob Dylan in the early 60s. It was a big hit for Peter, Paul, and Mary in the early 60s. Same thing. John Denver writes Leaving on a Jet Plane, and Peter, Paul, and Mary take it all the way to the top of the charts. So David, what I'd like to do is first, let's play we'll play 30 or 40 seconds or so, a minute or so of John Denver's Leaving on a Jet Plane. And then right away, follow up with about a minute or so of Peter, Paul, and Mary's version of Leaving on a Jet Plane.
All right. So I'm going to share my screen for everyone. Okay.
And you might want to put one of the photos of John Denver, one of the early photos there, photo one and photo two, if you'd like.
Oh, okay, I will. We'll see if I can be that complicated. I mean,
I know I can. Hey, there we go.
All right, so here's John Denver.
All my bags are packed, I'm ready to go. I'm standing here outside the door. I hate to wake you up to say goodbye, but the dawn is breaking, it's early morn. The taxi's waiting, he's blown his horn. Already I'm so lonesome I could die. So kiss me and smile for me. I hate you.
And here's Peter, Paul, and Mary doing the same song, their version.
You look vaguely familiar.
Well, not quite yet.
All my bags are packed, I'm ready to go. I'm standing here outside your door.
So if you compare the two, and again, I would suggest if you're interested, go back after this little discussion is over and sometime when you have some free time, you can listen to both of them and compare and contrast them even more so than we're doing here for, and of course, we're cutting it a little bit close just because of time. But if you listen, go back and you listen to John Denver's version, it has drums, it has a beat to it, right? It is a more pop flavored version of that song. Basically, the original title, by the way, was Babe, I Hate to Go. All right. And he changes it to Leave It on a Jet Plane. But that version was poppier. All right. And it had to be trying to put John Denver in connection to the whole thing that was happening in 1969 with rock. 1969, of course, being the year of Woodstock and all the incredible things that are happening in rock at that time, of course, with the Beatles and Led Zeppelin and Cream and so many other bands. But with Leaving on a Jet Plane with Peter, Paul, and Mary, you have a completely different point of view here. It's more folk-based, all right? And the reason why it's more folk-based is because, look, Peter, Paul, and Mary had an entire decade to create an audience. And that audience had expectations that despite the fact that this song is being played on pop radio stations, that it maintained its folk connection. And of course, Mary Travers was singing the lead there. They had great harmony, something that John didn't have, Peter, Paul, and Mary being a trio, okay? And it was a record that basically hit it just beautifully at the right time. And I always thought, why didn't John Denver's version of the song have the success that Peter, Paul, and Mary's did? Well, two reasons. One, as I said before, Peter, Paul, and Mary had a track record, okay? Everyone knew who Peter, Paul, and Mary was in the 1960s. They were that popular, folk or rock or pop. And the second thing is that 1969, as I said, was such an incredible year for music, the kind of major acts that were breaking, that were just emerging, were mostly hard rock acts, hard rock acts. So someone who comes in with something that's basically soft rock didn't stand much of a chance on the radio unless you had a track record. So it would make sense that Peter, Paul, and Mary, of the two, would be the one to break with this song. And of course, they take that up. If I'm not mistaken, it goes all the way to number one. And it probably is their only number one record other than Blowing in the Wind, which I believe only went to number two on the pop charts. I should have looked it up. I didn't. I'm sorry, but I'm pretty sure that's the case. But still, John Denver has a hit, right? Much like Bob Dylan had a hit with Blowing in the Wind, even though it wasn't his version. But now people are beginning to take him seriously. Songwriters, producers, etc. And very quickly in 1970, he releases two other albums. So 1969, Rhymes and Reasons comes out. And in 1970, Take Me to Tomorrow and Whose Garden Was This? Both of them come out in 1970. Back then, you could put out two albums in 1 year. That hardly ever happens today. If you go back to the Beatles, sometimes the Beatles did three albums in the early days in 1 year. Such was the nature of the music business back then. And there was so much desire for new music by established artists in particular. But basically, the idea that John Denver scored with Leaving on a Jet Plane through Peter, Paul, and Mary, the thought was, okay, this guy is going to be able to launch his own career. And quite honestly, RCA is kind of disappointed because of those two albums in 1970, neither sells well. Neither get attention from the music critics. They kind of just kind of float by. Like I said, there is a sea, a flood of incredible albums coming out. And the interesting thing is, in 1970, 71, what you're looking at, particularly, I guess, by 71, the album comes out. If you recall, if you're old enough to recall Carole King's Tapestry, all right? But also think about James Taylor is coming out now for the first time. And we have Jackson Browne and all of these, Joni Mitchell. There's this move away from the hard rock of the late 1960s and into a softer version of rock and pop in the early 1970s. So it was kind of interesting that John Denver doesn't score in 1970s, just as this wave is starting. But in 1971, with Poems, Prayers, and Promises, bingo, it hits. Okay, so the same year that Tapestry comes out, I guess it's 50 years ago, wow. Tapestry comes out, Poems, Prayers, and Promises comes out, and that basically is his hit album, all right? That is his hit album. And there is a song that happens on this album. David, I want you to cue it up. If you don't know this song by John Denver, I don't know what you're doing listening to me talk about it. Here it is.
All right, here we go.
Go to, oh, oh, Take Me Home, Country Roads. Go that one. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, I had these backwards here. My bad. Just to the right there. Yeah. You need to know that song too, of course, especially if you're from Colorado.
I'm sweaters older than her.
Sorry, sorry, sorry. These ads. Try to get it back. Yeah.
Buddy. Buddy?
Happy days are here again.
So I'm not going to play the whole song because clearly you should know that song. It is a classic. And the reason why I play that one first, and then we'll play Rocky Mountain High, a little bit of that one, is because this is the song that basically puts John Denver in the country category, right? Take Me Home, Country Roads. All right. Listen to the lyrics of this particular song. There are references to country. It's not an urban song. This is a song also that connects John Denver with Colorado as well, all right? He, by the name, Denver isn't his real name. It's Deutschendorf, right? And it's Henry John. And he changes his name because that was a terrible name to be to try and present himself in the pop world. Way too difficult to say, too ethnic, and then also too too long. So he changes it to John Denver, and really he changes it to Denver as a tribute to his favorite state, which is Colorado, okay? So what you have, and we're gonna hear Rocky Mountain High in just a second, Rocky Mountain High will actually become the state song of Colorado. But this puts John Denver in a situation where now all of a sudden he has an identity. He is considered to be a country artist. Colorado in the era of 1970, 71, 72, 73 is a very hip state to be connected to. Why? Because the whole hippie movement of the mid and late 1960s, which begins in places like Haight-Ashbury in San Francisco, the Sunset Strip in Los Angeles, Greenwich Village in New York, it begins as an urban cultural revolution. But by the late 60s and early 70s, the trend now is to move to the country, okay? You move to the country. And of course, Woodstock is the perfect example of that, where they celebrate going back to the garden. If you remember Joni Mitchell's song, Woodstock, take me back to the garden, basically the Garden of Eden that she's talking about. It's where basically you can be your own person and grow your own food and have freedom and clean air, et cetera. Well, John Denver connects into that through this song, because he, even though he's John Denver paying tribute to Denver, Colorado, the fact is the song is about rural America, pure America, a place that's away from the cities, which are very much struggling in the late 60s and early 70s. It is a great song. It is a classic song. We know as music critics, when we listen to songs that have redeeming merit, we listen to the lyrics, of course, but musically, you listen for a song to see if it has a hook. And a hook is something that basically, if you imagine fishing, right? You throw a line out into the ocean, let's just say, it has a hook with bait. The fish bites on the hook and you got that fish. You control him and you reel him in. In the music business, you want to write a hook that will basically connect you with a listener, okay? They get hooked on a particular part of a song that they can't get out of their head. And oftentimes, it's in the chorus. And of course, with this song, it's right in the chorus, Take Me Home, Country Roads. Unbelievable, unbelievable hook. So this is a huge hit for him, and it connects him with the state of Colorado, which he will stay with, because in 1972, we get this song, Rocky Mountain High.
All right.
So that particular song, Rocky Mountain High, only re-emphasizes this connection to obviously not just Colorado, but rural country, more wholesome look at America rather than the deteriorating situation that is occurring in the cities. Rocky Mountains, of course, when you hear Rocky Mountains, it's almost synonymous with the state of Colorado. And at the same time, this is all happening. And John Denver's career has really taken off. He's got these connections to country music and he's got connections to Colorado. I mentioned Colorado being a hip state in the early 1970s, because not just John Denver writing about the state, but some of you may know the music of the late Dan Fogelberg. He would do the same thing. He would write a lot about Colorado. He lived out there as well. Even the Beach Boys, who were so connected to Southern California, the Beach Boys, after all, coming out of Hawthorne, California, right next to, right very close to LAX, if you know Southern California. But they were all about surfing and the beach and everything. They have a ranch out there called Caribou Ranch, which they build a recording studio. So they get connected to that. Crosby, Stills, and Nash, they get connected to Colorado. So all of a sudden, Colorado is a really hip place to live, to record, to be. And part of that was due to the music of John Denver. At the same time this is going on musically for John Denver, also what he's starting to do and really start to pick up is his interest in environmentalism and the ecology. Because in 1970, if I'm not mistaken, we have our first Earth Day, right? So the baby boom generation is now beginning to look at its connection to Mother Earth. And basically we realize that pollution and traffic and plastics and all these things that were a detriment to the environment, basically the generation says, we need to fix this. We need to clean this up. We need to pay attention to the environment, to Mother Earth, so to speak. And John Denver is at the forefront of that, and he will never leave that. As a matter of fact, as the years now go by and he becomes very, very famous, very popular, very wealthy, he puts a lot of time and effort into environmentalism, so much so, in my opinion, that it rivals what he does with music, okay? But he is an advocate of it, and quite honestly, back then, he does not get the credit again, because I go all the way back to what I said early on in this little discussion here, because John Denver is still considered, despite his success, despite the great music that he's turning out, still considered to be a lightweight artist. You know, and people say, how can that be? How can that be? I can only offer you some theories. Number one, the music was incredibly wholesome. You don't hear any even electric guitars, right? It's all acoustic. It's soft, embracing. It's emotional. But he doesn't do anything that raises any eyebrows, let's say, musically speaking. It's easy to embrace. It's easily accessible. It's kind of conservative, quite honestly, too. But equally, on top of that, if David, put up that photograph of John Denver again, if you will. Not from the album, but one back, I guess it was. Look at the wholesome quality. Look at him. Even though he is wearing long hair, which, of course, is the basically motive of fashion for singer-songwriters. But the fact is, he's just got a wholesome face. He doesn't look like there's a bad bone in his body. He's not someone who's a radical. He's not someone who's doing hardcore drugs, getting arrested. I mean, he just looks like a great guy who lives and loves the outdoors and is connected to it musically as well as spiritually. So as a result, pushes along this idea that John Denver, well, yeah, he's good, but not someone to take seriously as a real artist. And he wasn't basically breaking down any new barriers. You know, the music that he was writing was basically out of that folk, pop, country vein. And if you listen to his music, and then you might listen to now maybe the Eagles or Jackson Browne, Joni Mitchell, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, they're going toward a harder version of that folk pop country stuff that John Denver was doing. And therefore, it was a little bit more appealing to serious music fans. Now, that's not to say John Denver's music wasn't serious. I'm saying that the music critics generally speaking, not all of them, but generally speaking, saw it as something that, yeah, it's great. It's kind of, it's okay, but you know, it's not something that rivals some of the artists I just mentioned. And I think that bothered John Denver. It had to, because he knew he was writing great songs. Certainly his audience was big for them, and he had a great following. But basically, I don't think at some point, I think at some point that he finally said, the heck with it, you know, I'm just going to do my thing. And he starts to move away a little bit away from caring about whether his music is critically accepted or not. Now, interestingly enough, by the time we get into the late 70s and into the 80s and things, you have a situation where he adds another interest in his life. And of course, this is the interest that ultimately would take his life, and that's aviation. Now, it certainly must come from his roots, because his father was in the Air Force, as I said. He always had an interest in aviation, even experimental aviation, to the point of, you know, thinking about back then space travel and what that might mean. So he was way ahead of his time in terms of how he looked at the future of aviation. So he really had three things going in his life all at once. He had the music, of course, which gave him the financial freedom to work on his interest in experimental aviation and, of course, environmentalism. It's interesting, and I bring this up simply because of my connection to the Grammys. In the Grammy Awards had been around since the late 1950s, but it really doesn't become a TV program until the early and mid-1970s. And in the late 1970s, basically, John Denver is asked to host it. So this is a really interesting thing, because here I am saying, the critics from Rolling Stone and some of the hardcore music journals are kind of just looking at John Denver as a lightweight folk country rocker, okay? But yet the Grammys are interested in him enough, and they see the value of the wholesomeness and his wide audience that he has, that he's asked to host the Grammys, and he will do such a good job, he will be asked to host it again and again. I forget exactly how many times he hosts, but it's more than two or three times, which is very unusual to be asked to come back. Usually we try and change the host, not so much anymore. These days, the whole idea of the Grammy Awards is all up in the air post-COVID. But the fact of the matter is, he was a favorite. And the reason why he was asked back, because people were drawn to the Grammys when they were just starting out as a TV show because of the popularity and love of John Denver. And I remember talking to Pierre Cassette, the late Pierre Cassette. He is the person who put the Grammys on TV. And I was doing like an oral history with him. And I asked him, this was years ago, 15 years ago or so, when he was still alive. I asked him about the John Denver. He said he loved John Denver, was one of the easiest hosts to work with. And basically he just brought people who might not be interested in the Grammy show to the show, meaning their eyeballs on TV, because of who he was and the loyalty of the fans to John Denver. Interesting. So before we start to wrap up here, you know, the 80s and 90s, he's still making records. Like I said, he goes perhaps up around 30 albums, I think, if you look. Interestingly, only one, a children's album will win a Grammy, even though it was nominated a couple of times. For someone with the length of his career, the number of albums, and his connection to the Grammys, as I said, it is kind of shocking that he only won one Grammy in his life. And that, in my opinion, you know, 20,000 people vote on Grammy Awards. Few people pick the nominations, but then the entire Recording Academy votes on it. And that, in my view, goes back to that reputation that we talked about, which explains that people said, John Denver, they loved him, but they didn't take him seriously enough to say that person is an innovative artist who basically is someone that deserves a Grammy Award. And now when we look back and you see some of the albums that won, as opposed to the records that he created, you're kind of surprised, you know. But I will throw that I can't remember exactly how many Grammy Awards Elvis Presley won, but I know he never won a Grammy Award for rock. He won Grammy Awards for his gospel albums. So back then, I can't explain to you why people voted the way they did, but it was pretty odd. And it was sometimes not fair, but that's the way it goes. He still remained a very, very important artist. And I want to play two more songs for you. David, if you would just cue up our fourth song, and we'll make sure that everyone, if you don't know this song, you shouldn't be listening to me now. You should be listening to John Denver's songs. But let's play, and then we'll play Waiting for a Train and talk about the children's album and wrap up.
Sounds good.
Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on a griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. When the work's all done and the sun's set low, pull out my fiddle and I'm rossing up the bow. Kids are asleep, so I keep a catalog. And thank God I'm a country boy. I'd play Sally Gooden all day if I could, but the Lord and my wife wouldn't take it very good. So a fiddle when I can.
So, thank God I'm a country boy. Take me home, country roads, Rocky Mountain High. You see, John Denver went back to the well, if you will, again and again. But when he did, he came up with absolute classics. That song today, you can go to baseball games. You can go to football games, college football games. You can go to bars. You can go to, oh my God, karaoke. Forget it. It's almost like, If the definition of a folk song is a song sung by many, many, many people and transcends generations, well, those two songs in particular are folk songs. They're part of the American music canon, so to speak. And so does his legacy still live on? Yes, it does. But like I said before, why wouldn't a song like this win a Grammy Award? I scratch my head today wondering what were the voters thinking. But they did pick, like I said, there was a children's album that was his last album before his death in 1997, due, as you probably know, to a plane crash, an experimental plane, 53 years old, not even close to finishing up his career. But interestingly enough, that wins a Grammy, and not for best album or anything like that. We won one of the minor awards, but listen to this album, which for the most part are cover songs of classics, particularly country music classics. So they're not even his songs. They are versions of classic songs done in a children's, if you will, music format. Here's a song called Waiting for a Train. It's by Jimmy Rogers. If you know anything about country music, Jimmy Rogers is considered the father of country music. So here's a song called Waiting on a Train. It was not meant to be back in the early, late 20s, early 30s. It was not meant to be a children's song, but John Denver turns it to him, because what he does with this song, as you can see here, is he creates, using the railroad, a series of songs that are connected to the railroad, Waiting for the Train. Perfect example. So let's listen to about a minute of that, if you will, David.
All around the water tower, waiting for the train, a thousand miles away from home, sleeping in the rain. I walked up to just to give them a line to get off, you railroad bum. He slammed that boxcar door. Oh, lady, oh, lady, oh, lady.
You hear the country twang of this, of course, and of course yodels. The yodel was a very famous vocal move that was employed by Jimmy Rogers back then, and made yodeling very much a part of the country music sound in the 1930s and 1940s. And John Denver recalls that on this album. And like I said, it is his last album, and it is the album that wins a Grammy Award. It's an album that quite honestly was aimed at children. It wasn't even aimed at his main constituency. So where does that leave us? Now, John Denver's been dead quite a long time. Where is his legacy today? How do we view him? As I said, a new generation of music journalists and critics and people who analyze and critique music, they're starting to see more value than the baby boomer music critics. So his stature is rising, and we saw that firsthand at the Grammy Museum when we did the exhibit that I spoke to you about at the outset of this. So you had that going on, and now you also have that connection where he is being recognized as much for his environmental work as he currently is with his music. So you have a situation here. If you add to the space travel that's starting to happen today, and interest in aviation going way beyond the conventions of flying, which were, of course, standard in his time, he was way ahead of his time in many, many ways. And so I think it's fair for us to say that John Denver's legacy, both music and environmental, is well assured. And as we go forward into the 21st century, we'll go back and look at his music and find even more redeeming values and qualities to it than perhaps we found when he was alive. That's sad, okay? And it's something that I think was largely unfair, but he's not the only artist that happened to, quite honestly. A number of artists who you would just say, my goodness, such a great artist, why doesn't he sell more records, or why isn't he recognized more? No one said the music business was fair. And I think John Denver came to grips with that long before a lot of the other artists did. And for the most part, despite dying at an early age of 53, I think he led a pretty good life and was pretty happy with what he had accomplished. So with that, I will stop, and I'll see if there are any questions or comments that anyone might have. I see Q&A here, so let me open that up.
So Bob, real quick, we'll go. I'll kind of moderate, and I'll read the question.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
But I gotta say, thank you for that. And just on a personal note, I mean, I'm one of those fans.
Yeah,
John Denver has touched my life in so many different ways. And even, I mean, I kept singing, you know, when those were playing. I think a lot of people were probably singing along with those lyrics. So just to remind people, we have time for a few questions. And so you can use the Q&A feature at the bottom. And the first question we have is this. In the comic strip Doonesbury, the character of Duke, loosely based on gonzo journalist Hunter Thompson, for some reason hated John Denver. In real life, was there animosity between Denver and Thompson for some reason?
There wasn't personal animosity, but Hunter Thompson wrote for Rolling Stone, right? He was one of he was caustic, he was radical, unpredictable, nasty. This was a tough guy, Hunter Thompson, that is, to be admired by. And to him, because he lived out there as well, right? He lived out in Colorado as well. And he saw John Denver as everything that he hated about Colorado, the pure wholesomeness, the conservativeness, anything that basically smacked of, if it wasn't about drugs or guns or anything, Hunter Thompson wasn't interested in it. I only met him once. And it was only in distance. I was at a party in New York when I was writing for Rolling Stone. And I didn't even go up and speak to him. But he would, when he would walk into a room, he would get a lot of the most caustic, skeptical, sometimes arrogant people around him. And if you were to ask me, if I didn't know what I just said, if you said, Bob, do you think Hunter Thompson liked John Denver or John Denver's music? I would laugh and say, are you crazy? Of course not. It'd be impossible given who he was. So yeah, so it wasn't a personal thing. It was what John represented that he hated most, because he saw Colorado as more of a rebel area, an outlaw area, a place where you shoot them up and take drugs and go crazy, as opposed to the beauty and the if you will, middle class comfort that John Denver brought to the state. So there was that disconnect, and it was perfectly represented in Doonesbury.
Yes, I also met Hunter S. Thompson once at a job I had, and you described him perfectly. People actually came, it was for a book signing.
Yeah.
And people came with a book that Hunter S. Thompson had actually shot a bullet through.
There you go.
And that was like their most prized possession. Yeah. So yeah. Yes. So can you speak to the effect that John Denver's testimony to Congress about labeling on albums had on his career and music?
Yeah, I don't know enough really to speak forcefully about that. I can say I don't think it did. I don't think it did. John Denver's hill to climb was always vast right from the very, very beginning. And it's really a tribute to people like yourself, David. You said he's spoken to you and you've related to him, that you stayed with him. Because as I said, there's one element, even before I did we did the exhibit at the Grammy Museum. There's one thing that I knew about John Denver's fans, and it was loyal, okay? If you connected to John Denver, you connected to him, and you stayed connected to him. And that's really, he was very fortunate that he had such loyal fans, because again, back then in the 70s in particular, music journalism and like Rolling Stone, et cetera, they were very powerful. They could make or break an artist, right? They could, people read these magazines and looked at them. And if they said this album was great, they believed it was great. If this album was terrible, they believed it was terrible. It had incredible power, incredible power. I like to think, you know, I don't know, is there any other questions there? I don't see any.
Just a comment, you know, saying kind of what you reiterated, how John Denver, you know, his songs followed the life. But we did just get one question. If you could briefly speak to John Denver's spiritualism, and then we'll kind of wrap it up after that.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I that's an area, quite honestly, I probably can't. Being the music person, I don't know enough about that aspect of his life, unfortunately, to speak clearly about it. But I can say this, in his music, there is, you know, if you see a supreme being in nature, right? And you see it in the manner by which we relate to Mother Earth, the spiritualism is organic with him and homegrown. And a lot of people who, when he is coming up and creating his, if you will, reputation, who he is, there was a lot of interest in all of that. And of course, he will take that and it will grow more mature and sophisticated as the years go by. But for me, spiritualism aside, as I mentioned to you before, I'm from New Jersey. And of course, in New Jersey, we have Bruce Springsteen. And for us, for me as a kid growing up, you know, Bruce Springsteen wrote about New Jersey. And a lot of the things, you know, I'm sure people from Iowa or Missouri or Arizona, they're thinking, they probably didn't recognize that music. But he wrote very, very forcefully and successfully about it. I always think of John Denver as Colorado's Bruce Springsteen, you know, where he really not only connected to the vibe of the place and the purity of the place. Now, New Jersey is not pure or anything. We're the most densely populated state in the union, and we've got pollution and mafia and everything like that. But Denver just embodied the best parts of that state. I always saw Bruce Springsteen as the William Faulkner of New Jersey because of his ability to say what I just said. And I saw John Denver being the same way. we might need a few more of those John Denvers. And, you know, it'd be interesting to see, like I said, as it goes by, you're still a John Denver fan. I think people who are listening and are still John Denver fans. The whole point of something like this is now to go back and re-listen to the music, you know, get reconnected to it, because clearly it's a part of your life, David. And you know, for someone like me, whose business is music, I don't get to do that so much anymore. There's so much I have to listen to and react to. But for you guys as fans, go back, stay connected to the music, stay connected to his legacy, find new inspiration in it, and new things about the music and his life that make you feel good and make you feel whole. I think that's really the hope I could leave you with as we begin to close.
Beautifully said, Bob. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you all for joining us today. And don't forget, our next Connected Conversation is coming up. You can learn more information on our website on the Connected Conversations page. Bob, thanks again.